any further ado, I want to introduce you to Jason Goodwill. Jason, welcome to RICO Busters.
Thank you, David.
That was wave one, and so...
That was...
Yeah, I want to hear how you fought these off. I mean, how many years... They stuck you in prison for some number of years? How many?
About 3 years.
Uh-huh. Oh, my God.
And this was a private one. This is not one where I had ready access to an attorney, where I could contact people. My friends did not know where I had disappeared to. I was simply gone. The mayor's office did not know what happened to me. I was stuck in a box that was about 8x12 with no windows and treated horrifically for years.
Oh my God.
Just so that I could not testify.
And so you, there was no due process, there was no conviction at that time, there was no trial by jury, there was no prosecutor, there's no anything, is that correct? And you had 3 years in the can?
Pretty much, yeah. And every now and again, I'd get pulled out, dragged in front of a judge. There was no witnesses, this was not open to the public. And this judge, he was as corrupt as the rest of them. But one by one, I'd get the charges dismissed. The first one, I just love the first one. I get brought up before the judge for robbing a bank. The judge asks the prosecutor, "What bank?" And the prosecutor says, "We haven't decided yet."
Oh, my God.
And this is how it went on and on. Now, you'd think if the judge was a man of integrity after this first one, he would have just thrown the whole thing out. But no, the point was to drag it on so that I couldn't testify. And in the meantime, these crooked politicians and these dirty cops are destroying evidence, threatening witnesses, leaving office, resigning, basically tying up their loose ends by keeping me buried.
Now, was this a Sheboygan district court judge, a state judge, or was this a federal judge?
Circuit.
Circuit, got it.
Yeah. And so
what's
eventually...
His name? By the way, I do like names, judges, and things like that.
Langhoff. Judge Langhoff.
Thank you.
And he left office immediately after my case.
Langhoff.
So, yes. Judge Langhoff. So, we have involved here Police Chief Kirk. We have Judge Langhoff. We have the district attorney. I think they refer to him as prosecutors here in Michigan. His name is Joe DiCecco, which later on in Wave 3 will prove interesting because while he defended these dirty cops, he would also later be appointed as my attorney. No conflict of interest there.
Oh my gosh.
Mm-hmm. So, essentially what we have is District Attorney Joe DiCecco defending these dirty cops in a federal court. And later on in what I refer to as the third wave, he would actually be appointed as my counsel. No conflict of interest there. In the interim, while I was locked away, essentially a political prisoner with several other people, one of the others got out, and I was able to get some messages out with him. And fortunately, he delivered, and people began learning where I was and where I had disappeared to for so long. Now, what happened while I was locked up is most of these people left office, not all of them. What I also discovered, because Susan Hart came down to see me herself. That's the human, that's the resources director who worked directly for the mayor. She came down, and we had a private conversation in which she informed me that Officer John Winter, who was the primary dirty cop in this criminal ring, but certainly not the only one, was up in front of a federal court being deposed for the numerous crimes he had committed, crimes which I was supposed to have been testifying against. You have received a copy of that deposition, and they are rare. It is not often that a person ever sees a transcript of a dirty cop admitting to crimes and committing crimes within a federal court. In that deposition, he perjured himself dozens of times, so much so that even the judge stopped him at one point and asked him if he understood that he was under oath and asked him if he understood the definition of perjury. The cop admitted to being involved in racially motivated hate crimes. He admitted to falsifying police reports and fabricating evidence against me. He, you know, essentially admitted to the worst parts of all the charges I had tried to bring against him or testify to. He was never charged for any of these crimes.
Unbelievable.
And he resigned. During his resignation, he went very public in stating that he was having an affair with Jennifer Reisinger. And so that kind of tied those two together as to how that had been occurring. So, you know, essentially what you have is corrupt cops who have a racial hatred for the mayor, are using, you know, a resource, Miss Reisinger, to leak information and blackmail the mayor by trying to attack his son. And in order to cover all of this up, they attacked and threatened the witnesses, including myself. So, in the end, dozens upon dozens of felony charges, years of false imprisonment, and I managed to finally get out. But now everybody who is involved in this massive criminal conspiracy is pretty much gone. But the problem is, the witnesses still remain. And the witnesses filed a RICO suit. I join in the RICO suit. And thus begins wave two. Winter is more or less out of the picture. He has resigned. He has disgraced himself in a federal court. He has admitted to committing all these crimes. But he left his friends in the police department holding the bag. Now we have Officer Joel Clark. Now, when Winter committed his raid on me in the first place and went out to destroy all the evidence, it was him and Joel Clark and Todd Preby and Jeff Johnson and Veezer and one other officer. His name escapes me for the moment, but you know, they're all working in the police department. One of the questions that was brought up in the court is, what was Winter doing out there in the first place? Because he's basically a desk jockey. He does paperwork. So what's he doing leading a six-man raiding party? Never did answer it. But it wasn't overlooked. So Winter's gone. Now we've got Joe Clark and the rest of the gang left holding the bag, RICO suit coming at the city. Mayor's walked out of office. Judges walked out. You know, other cops have walked out. The police chief has resigned. These new officials coming in sure don't want to be facing a RICO suit first thing off the bat. They need to get rid of the witnesses. The confidential witness list was released by the Attorney General to Governor Scott Walker. Governor Scott Walker is probably the most powerful and corrupt official in the state's history. For all the stuff you don't know, if you followed any of Scott Walker's political history, this is the guy who destroyed the state's unions. He's crippled the state's economy. He has been involved in numerous racketeering crimes. And although there have been numerous attempts to take him down, he is so well protected that nobody has been able to do it yet. Shortly after, witnesses begin disappearing. But before that happens, Clark files what I call the second wave against me. His charges keep changing over and over. First, he's accusing me of credit card fraud. Well, it's proven that five of the six credit cards he's named off don't even exist. For someone who's supposed to be a police detective, you'd think he'd be a little smarter than that. Then he tries saying that, I was involved in breaking and entering into Reisinger's place. Well, Reisinger testified, well, that's a crock of bull, that never happened, so that gets thrown out. He keeps changing the charges and changing the charges and changing the charges until we get to what will lead into wave three. So, you know, I finally beat all the charges. He's wanted for arson. Well, you know, what building did he burn down? Well, you know, we don't know yet. He's wanted for murder. The murder? Who'd he murder? We're not sure yet. Yeah, I mean, it just went on and on like that.
So they were being dropped one at a time over the course of this 3 years when they'd pull you out every once in a while hold a hearing on that particular charge.
After hearing so many of these fraudulent charges, any judge worth his integrity should have taken these dirty cops, taken the prosecutor, charged them, and thrown them in prison. Not in Sheboygan. Because this isn't a court of law. This is an obstruction of justice. This is preventing an eyewitness from bringing major charges and damages against the city. Well, eventually, I would defeat all of the original charges, and I did get out and discovered that I was not the only witness. I was not the only one bringing charges against the city. You know, even some of the neighbors who had witnessed my arrest had filed charges and criminal complaints and were themselves being threatened.
Wow.
In your documents, you will have several handwritten letters from eyewitnesses who attested to the fact that these cops nearly beat me to death. And the courts, the sheriff, the responsible agencies who are supposed to deal with such police brutality, did nothing. When these witnesses reported that these cops were coming around and threatening them, nothing was done. So these people joined together and filed a RICO suit against the city of Sheboygan, and I joined in with that suit. That began the second wave. And in the second wave, Joe Clark, leading the new ringleader of these dirty cops, started throwing more fraudulent charges and kept changing the charges. until finally he introduces April Seymour. I knew Miss Seymour from the street. As I said previously, I ran a rescue mission, and you know, I along with others helped homeless people, people who were having problems in their homes, things of that nature. And I ran across Miss Seymour. Now, I've also told you that I've done work with art and photography. Miss Seymour was an exceptionally attractive person. And she gave me this big story about how her life had fallen apart. And I told her I could probably get her a job doing some amateur modeling for a decent company. In fact, I was able to get her a contract with JCPenney's. I have signed contracts. You yourself now have a copy of those contracts. Mm-hmm. And that's basically how I knew Miss Seymour. She was a person living on the streets. I helped get her off the streets. I helped her get work. When Clark got a hold of her and essentially used her against me, first he tried claiming I had raped her. She went up on the stand and said, not only did I rape her, I never even touched her. Thrown out. So Clark revises his story and revises it and revises it and revises it until he says, well, what we have here is an underaged girl who witnessed nude photos on my computer. And as a direct result, she has been so psychologically traumatized and damaged that the state has to bring charges against me.
And this guy Clark, if you don't mind me interrupting, he was a fellow police officer to Winters or a prosecutor?
Police officer. He was a detective in the department.
Got it. Thank you. Sheboygan.
Sure. So what follows is a complete farce, mock trial, kangaroo court, call it what you will. It was unbelievable. We have Miss Seymour, and you have the court transcripts of this.
Okay.
We have Miss Seymour perjuring herself repeatedly. We have her admitting to the fact that she was telling the courts what the police had instructed her to say. We have her changing stories left and right. We have her caught up in such a way that There was another officer involved in this, and he wasn't directly involved. His involvement was strictly on Seymour's end. Seymour, she was a runaway. So we do confirm the fact that she was living on the streets when I tried helping her out. And she had provided false identification. She had provided false age. And this is something that Clark tried to use against me in the beginning, but was all thrown out because the only thing I ever did is helped her with some modeling and getting a job. There is absolutely nothing illegal about that. Even if she lied about her age, in the United States, in every state, a female may model from age 13 on up without parental consent, so long as there's no nudity or anything of that sort involved. And there never was. So there was no crime. So once again, Clark has to revise his charges. This is where he says, well, she saw nude pictures on a computer. Well, this officer Zempel comes in And he provides a statement about the conditions of Miss Seymour, and in doing so, accidentally punches a big hole in the prosecution, because he tells about a police report of April Seymour's arrest. Well, according to the prosecution, Miss Seymour has never been in trouble with the law. She's never been arrested. She's their perfect angel. This leads to a wonderful word that I learned called exculpatory. And exculpatory, for those who don't know it, essentially means when the prosecutor withholds evidence that can prove the defense's innocence. A demand for discovery is put in, and it not only proves that the prosecution was hiding evidence of her criminal background, it proves a second count of exculpatory, which leads to more discovery and more records. And in short, what we have is April Seymour was arrested for drug possession, drug use, and prostitution. There's another eyewitness statement in there which also states that April Seymour has perjured herself repeatedly in other cases on behalf of the Sheboygan Police Department.
So she was a regular. She was a regular that they were using. It looks like she was a regular. And who was the prosecutor in this particular situation?
I believe his name was Haberman.
Haberman.
Yeah. What we have now is the prosecution is guilty on multiple counts of exculpating critical evidence. My attorney, out of his own pocket, hires a nationally renowned computer forensic specialist named Steve Odenthal. You have his papers there as well.
Okay.
Mr. Odenthal is brought in to examine all of the prosecutor's evidence. And what he discovers is that they have fabricated evidence, they have falsified records, and in short, there is no collaborating physical evidence whatsoever. The court throws out all of the prosecutor's physical evidence. So we have no physical evidence whatsoever in this case. In addition, through these discoveries, because of this exculpation of documents, it is discovered that there were two eyewitness statements. And this was important because I had told my attorney there were other people present every time April Seymour was around me. I was never with her alone. So we find out that these two witnesses on their own went in and made a police statement. They were, of course, investigated. Their statements were recorded. And the prosecution buried those statements because both of these people attested to the same thing, which I had stated, that at the time Miss Seymour was near me, or in my place, or in my presence, my computer at the time was broken down. It couldn't be used to show anything. The video card had been damaged, and a new one was on order. So here we have the prosecution actually burying eyewitness statements counter to their hearsay witness. Their hearsay witness, having already committed multiple counts of perjury, having changed her story repeatedly, having admitted to being coerced and instructed by the police department, all they have is this hearsay witness.
And again, this is still in a Sheboygan circuit court, is that correct?
Yes, this is still in the Sheboygan court.
And had the...
Still with the same judge.
And had the...
Langhoff.
Okay, Langhoff? Mm-hmm.
Langhoff.
And had the federal RICO case started yet at, by this time, or did that come after?
It was starting to roll along, but it was just being picked up in the federal courts.
Okay.
So, it's impertinent for Sheboygan to destroy their most credible witness, which, is to my knowledge, is myself. There were other witnesses to the crimes that were involved, but none of them were actually witnesses to the racial hate crimes that underlie this entire thing, to the physical evidence that was discovered in the computers, to the logs, to the IP traces, to the first-hand eyewitnesses of what these cops had done, to the physical assault of what these cops had done. Now, there were other witnesses to the threats and to the death threats that were made and to the destruction of the evidence, but I was the earliest witness, which meant, you know, as far as they are concerned, they had to stop me.
And what about what about the mayor? I mean, at what point did he help at all?
Out of office. He walked out of office. I mean, literally walked out. He said, "I've had it."
And so he
didn't
would
even
not,
file a resignation.
He did not help. He didn't do anything to back you up.
They were threatening his family, and he was doing what he could to get his family out of the state. In fact, he ended up sending them down to Texas. And no, he basically left me hanging.
Got it.
So, so basically what happens is in this farce, this fiasco of a court, a three-ring circus, with everything that, you know, that's happened, the judge still says, you're guilty. By now, I've already served a double maximum sentence. I get transferred over to Fox Lake and file a repeal or an appeal to the RICO suit to include this new information. And I'm released. I am given paperwork that I am a free man. I have no ties to the DOC. I have no ties to the DCC. I have no ties to the state of Wisconsin. And I can go. And go I did. I left the state.
Well, now, I have a question. I thought that the Constitution says that, nobody is tried except by, they aren't indicted except by a grand jury. And how can a judge single-handedly determine that you are guilty? Didn't you go get a jury at all to hear anything?
They brought in a jury consisting largely of local officials, police officers, firefighters, not a jury of my peers, but a jury of their peers.
And the prosecutor's got the exculpatory evidence that he's just not putting in before the jury. Is that correct?
Well, it was all brought up. I mean, the discovery was put through, the motion was approved, the evidence was turned over, and still, no charges were ever filed against the prosecution. Nothing was ever done against their hearsay witness. Nothing was ever done over the exculpation of evidence. Nothing was done over all the perjury. Nothing was done about the falsified records or the fabricated evidence presented by the police department, other than having it thrown out. Nothing. They just sat there and said, guilty.
Wow.
My attorney was so furious, he actually accused the courtroom of being involved in a witch hunt. He said, it is nothing more than a witch hunt, and that is in the transcripts. So, like I said, you know, and so on and so forth, and I left the state.
Well, one other question. You served already twice the maximum sentence. Maximum sentence happened to be probably a sex crime. Is that correct?
Well, it was a year and a half, and it was not considered a sex crime. There was no sex involved. There was no physical contact involved. Under the 2006 edition of the Adam Walsh Act, which is the version that was in effect at the time that this occurred, because it's been revised several times since then, at that time, the Adam Walsh Act made it very clear the conditions under which a person can be considered a sex offender. And it requires that there be explicit sexual conduct involved, rape, for example, you know, molestation, so on and so forth, and that you have to be processed under, or you have to be charged under due process of law. Due process of law most certainly never took place in this case. No qualifications whatsoever under the Adam Walsh Act to declare my case a sexual assault case.
Got it.
I leave Michigan, and what is it? We're up to 2013. I've been in Michigan for several years. Witnesses have disappeared. We began the third wave. I know I'm amongst other witnesses on the list. I don't know how many witnesses there were in total. I became privileged to just a handful of names. Of the ones that I know about, Lois suddenly died, presumably from a cancerous tumor. The fact that there was a chemical tank found attached to her house's water supply with toxic levels of chemicals in that tank was just kind of overlooked.
By the Sheboygan police, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
We've got, let's see, Terry disappeared after being threatened by the Sheboygan police. After 3 years, was declared presumably dead. Dave died of a sudden heart attack. Mike had his head suddenly crushed in by a burglar who didn't steal anything. We have, and you have the news article on, a copy of the news article on this, yeah. One of the other witnesses who just happened to spontaneously combust inside of his car. And myself. Well, with most of the witnesses, if not all the other witnesses, gone, the RICO suit began falling apart. I refiled to have it amended from John Doe versus City of Sheboygan to Goodwill versus City of Sheboygan. That kept the suit going. It certainly didn't help me, because there is no justice system left in this country. The court ruled.
Federal court. Federal court. Can we, you know, I have a problem with the use of the word the court did this and the court did that. I got real problems with that. Because I personally, when I'm calling this out as being, as we the people dealing with domestic terrorists that are in these positions of power and authority that have been usurped by people who call themselves the court. And so, you know, and the records and the transcripts show the court when I know who was sitting at the bench. And so I would like to, between us, if you believe that it was the court, I believe that it was the person. And if you can refer to the judge of that court, if you want to even call it a court anymore.
Right. See, that's the problem I have. I look at the circuit court, the appeal court, and there's another aspect we didn't touch on is the appeal court. The federal court, in my opinion, there's no difference anymore because they're all criminals. You've got the higher courts protecting the lower courts. You got the lower courts protecting the DAs. You got the DAs protecting the dirty cops. And they're all conspiring and collaborating together to deprive the American people of their civil liberties. Now, they're all criminals. Period. That's not what this country is supposed to be about.
Absolutely.
So
we've got domestic terrorists in our midst, and they're running this country, and we have no constitution that's in effect. We've completely lost the judiciary.
Well, yeah, and you know, what I say is a law that's not upheld is not a law at all. If the courts are unwilling to back the Constitution, what's the point of having the courts?
Right.
We might as well go back to the old West system and might makes right, you know, just start shooting everybody again.
Phase two. The second part of this basically was your appeal and the RICO action that was starting to take place and the disappearance of the witnesses. Is that correct?
Correct. During the second wave, after I got all these charges removed, except for this last one where they claimed I allowed this child to see hazardous materials, that being the photos on the computer that never worked while she was there, I filed for an appeal. Obviously, there's so much perjury and evidence tampering and everything involved, and was subject to 11 months of client abandonment, by which time my chance, the time frame to file an appeal fell apart. I tried to fire the attorney, only to have the state of Wisconsin tell me I'm not allowed to fire my attorney.
Now, and when that's the situation here in Michigan, too. Again, I'd like to know who this attorney is and by name that has stood you up. Is he a Wisconsin attorney or a Michigan attorney?
Wisconsin attorney. It's a female. Mm-hmm. Geike. You have a copy of the document.
All right, we'll put it up.
So you have a copy of the document. And because of this, Michigan doesn't give you a choice. Wisconsin does. Wisconsin says that you can fire an attorney for any reason, justifiable or not justifiable. If you don't want this attorney, you don't have to have this attorney. And still, the state of Wisconsin responded by saying, I could not fire this attorney. The attorney agreed to being fired. The state chewed her out and said, you have a moral and ethical obligation to your client. And from what I've been told, that's about the most, it's the strongest, you know, reprimand ever given to an attorney. And it was Joseph Eamon, the first assistant state public defender, who basically called her actions unethical and told her that she had a moral obligation to represent her client.
But yet she didn't do it. She still let this thing flounder for the entire appeals time, and you lost your appeal.
Correct.
Got it.
So now we start heading into phase three. I'm in the state of Michigan. come back to my roots, as it were. And I'm here for several years. 2013, I'm supposed to go back to Wisconsin to testify within the RICO suit. And instead, I am arrested as an escaped rapist from the state of Wisconsin.
And you're arrested in Michigan.
And what's interesting about this is that there's a little troll named Sandy Cornell who works for the Department of Corrections. Now, she has falsified evidence. She's fabricated evidence. She has committed federal mail fraud. This was proven. She has done all of these crimes in order to obtain a warrant for my arrest. Now, a warrant obtained through that type of crime has no force. Yet, Governor Scott Walker, who, of course, is involved as a criminal in this RICO suit and who has obstructed justice in this matter before, approves the warrant. The state of Michigan approves it because we know how much Governor Schneider upholds the U.S. Constitution, not.
Right.
And the courts here go, we don't care if you're a RICO witness. We don't care if we're turning you over to the very criminals named in the RICO suit. We don't care if your rights were violated. We don't want you here. And I was, according to Wisconsin, extradited. According to constitutional law, federally kidnapped.
Well, absolutely. And this is by the people whose community you were brought, you lived in, you were brought up in, and who whose community you improved throughout your youth. Is that correct?
Correct. Yes. When I got my scholarship, the project that I did for Need Papers was to come up with an electrochemical process that pulls lead out of their paper-making pulp processing. That, in turn, removes the lead from the lake water, which saved the city millions of dollars in cleanup.
Of the city of Sheboygan? Sheboygan City?
That's a pretty good contribution. No, Escanaba.
Oh, okay.
In Escanaba. Yeah. I'd say that's a pretty good contribution to the city. I'm taken back to Sheboygan. Once again, thrown in that nasty hole, and once again prevented from testifying in the RICO suit. And throughout this entire process, the U.S. Marshal Office has refused to do anything to protect the witnesses. They informed my attorney previously that the reason they refused to do anything is that the state of Wisconsin is essentially bankrupt and they just can't afford to uphold that portion of the law, which says that they are supposed to place people under witness security, which the general public calls witness protection, and that it's just not going to happen. Too bad, tough luck, you're on your own. FBI refuses to get involved. U.S. Department of Justice refuses to get involved. Attorney General refuses to get involved. And of course, I find out through my attorney, well, the DOC and its sex offender division are a project established by the Attorney General and ran by the Department of Justice. One of the biggest criminal scandals in this nation is being run by the Department of Justice. And of course, as we touched upon earlier, the attorney appointed to represent me in this matter is Joe DiCecco, who represented the dirty cops earlier. Now, 6 months go by, And I'm finally brought before the court.
In Sheboygan.
Now, I notified DeCecco in Sheboygan. I notified DeCecco. I said, you know full well I've got this evidence. I said, you know full well I know the crimes that have been committed. And I says, and you better understand full well, I will make this as public as I can if this farce continues. So he goes to the prosecutor with the evidence that the DOC released me without condition, that the DCC released me without condition, that the state released me without condition, and that the governor's office provided release papers that I was 100% discharged as a free man. The prosecutor goes to the judge and says, we're not going to proceed. We are dismissing. Mr. Goodwill is not guilty of being in violation of sex offender registry laws, which is what should have happened.
And that is what year?
That was 2013.
2013, okay. And that's after you were extradited from Michigan to Sheboygan again, after you fled the state.
Yes.
Correct.
Correct. Now, federal law says that a state may not maintain falsified documents. These falsified documents were supposed to have been removed. But here is the rub. The DOC from Sheboygan put my name on the sex offender registry in direct violation of the federal mandates of the Adam Walsh Act, in direct violation of the charges in my case, in violation of due process of law. But the state of Wisconsin has no recourse whatsoever to take a person's name off the list, whether it's been put there legally or not. When there is no recourse, no redress against government action, it is a violation of due process of law under the 14th Amendment.
Well, and I beg to say that it's also a due process violation under the Fifth and, more importantly, the First Amendment, because you're being deprived of your right to a redress of grievances, period, through a non-access to the court. You're being denied the access to the court for one reason or another.
And not just me.
Yes.
The FBI estimates nearly 700,000 Americans in this nation right now are being subjected to the same criminal actions, which are little more than the system's way of discrediting eyewitnesses to police and officials' criminal actions.
To cover up.
It's a political prison system of defamation and character assassination. Michigan is even worse. Michigan has been found repeatedly by appeals courts, by their federal courts, and by the Supreme Court and the U.S. Supreme Court of having unconstitutional laws in this matter. But the courts say, as long as they're still on the books, we're going to keep on following them. Because every person we hold, we get paid.
Every person, yep.
One essentially started at the end of 2007.
Okay.
And that is when I actually came into possession of the evidence of the police crimes. Then that ran on for several years until eventually I was able to fight off all those dozens of charges. And phase two was started in roughly 2011 and ended in 2010 and ended at late 2011.
Okay, all right.
Then phase three was in 2013. You still there?
Yep, I'm still here. So you basically only had about 1 year that you were being left alone, 2012, right?
You're right.
Yeah.
Then, essentially, what is now starting phase four is 2016. And here I am once again, you know, I'm arrested. The arrest process itself wasn't even legal. Cops used my cell phone to search for me and then seize both person and property in one of the most rarest U.S. Supreme Court rulings. They unanimously voted that the use of a cell phone to search for a person's location without a warrant is unconstitutional. I was arrested and interrogated without being Mirandized. I notified them that I wanted an attorney, at which point, by law, they are not allowed to ask any further questions, yet they proceeded to do so. And, you know, I mean, it's just, when you look at if that's the way the legal process in this town is going to start, with the violation of your constitutional rights, we're talking unlawful seizure, unlawful search. We're talking violation of your first, your fourth, your fifth, your eighth, your ninth, your 14th Amendment rights. Right off the bat, we're half of the Bill of Rights violated.
Absolutely.
Right from the start. How can anybody expect to find justice in this system?
And now that's Michigan now.
This is Michigan now. Hometown. One of the other things they keep driving is they don't want this Wisconsinite, this rapist in their town, having completely forgotten all that I did for this town. And the cops are going around talking to people who they've discovered I know, and warning them that I'm an escaped child rapist. I haven't even been to court, and my charges don't even come close to this. It's complete defamation of character.
And they aren't your charges to begin with. It's their charges, and it's their... you did not have due process, none of that stuff, as we heard your story with before. I mean, it's just... this is stuff that they've slapped onto you and sent you running. They've intimidated all the witnesses that could help you. They when you took it to the federal level, it was completely botched. And
that's something I don't think we got to finish even, is what happened with the RICO suit. The reason it was thrown out, and you have a copy of this, it was thrown out on the grounds of the United States versus Nixon. And what that basically says is that when a person or a state or an entity commits a crime whose repercussions are so devastating that the courts don't have to accept the case, such as Nixon's crimes against the United States were so devastating, they didn't have to accept the case.
Oh my God.
And in this case, the crimes committed by Sheboygan officials, including the violation of the federal mandates of the Adam Walsh Act, are so devastating to the state of Wisconsin that if the courts upheld the law, the state would go bankrupt. So what they are saying is that so long as you commit a crime that is so horrific, so damaging, so unconstitutional that it will damage the entire state, we'll ignore it.
And they call that precedence, right? The precedence of the United States Constitution has no meaning there. The supremacy clause of the United States Constitution has no meaning when we're talking about the judiciary creating their own laws and then referring to their own laws as the legal precedence to throw our constitutional rights completely out the window. I see
precisely. It. Precisely. Yep. And so now what I'm facing is Michigan laws. And as I said before, numerous courts, including the U.S. Supreme Court, finds Michigan's laws in this regard to be some of the most unconstitutional ever that they have reviewed. Michigan is considered the fourth most corrupt state in the entire union when it comes to the violation of civil liberties and ethics in the courts. And that is nothing to be proud about.
I believe that. Because I wanted to show you this book right here. It's called
Judicial Deceit.
That is correct. Judicial Deceit. It's written by former Michigan Supreme Court Justice Elizabeth Weaver and Dr. David Schock. And the name of the book has a subtitle, which is called Tyranny and Unnecessary Secrecy at the Michigan Supreme Court. And you can see how thick it is. The reason why I bring this up is because it's well known here, made public by this whistleblower from the Supreme Court. And she was basically saying the same thing at the top that we've been saying at the so-called bottom, at the grassroots, that this entire judicial system here in Michigan is completely corrupted. And so,
I have to agree.
Yes.
Now, what I'm facing here is mechanics of the law versus spirit of the law. On one hand, my rights have been completely violated. But because my name was unlawfully placed on a list from which it cannot be removed, Michigan says we have no choice but to honor Wisconsin's laws and send you back to the very people who are trying to kill you and prevent you from testifying. I'm being charged for the second time with the same offense. The offense which I was already found not guilty of in the state of Wisconsin in the very court that initiated this mess in the first place. State of Michigan is saying this does not qualify as double jeopardy.
Huh.
I would disagree, but I'm not a constitutional lawyer. Now, the attorney who has been appointed to me isn't doing a whole lot because he's not getting paid a whole lot. And as a result, the prosecutor is doing a lot of work and I'm stuck in the middle. Now, we're supposed to go in for a pretrial. What was that on? On the 2nd. And we ended up with the prosecutor and my attorney and the judge talking off the record. Now, this prosecutor, she's a real piece of work. She is a real man-hater. She doesn't believe in any flexibility of the law.
What's your name?
And
her name?
And yes, Pertel. I've sent you a record on her as well.
Okay.
And she essentially wanted to throw all sorts of felony charges at me, wants to kick me out of the state of Michigan, wants me to be registered as a rapist, and anyways, very nasty person. Fortunately, my attorney did take a little bit of time to research some of the materials that I presented him because he wouldn't take the time to find them on his own and showed the judge, you know, I've already been found not guilty in the same situation for the same charge under the same circumstances. I was released as a free man. I had no ties according to state records. The fact that my name was unlawfully placed on that list and that there is no method to take it off other than to go through the very criminal who's named in the RICO suit, you know, isn't just, and that the mechanics of Michigan state law in this regard is simply not in the spirit of the law. The judge stated he had never seen a situation like this before. He says usually it's a black and white case, you know, person's escaped, they're not reporting, whatever. He says this isn't like what he's seen before.
What's the name of the judge?
And as such,
The name of the judge?
Judge Parks. There are only two judges in this town, Parks and Davids. In 2014, in another matter, I was asked by Judge Davis to turn over, you know, he requested it. It wasn't an order or anything. He just requested that he be able to look over all this information, and I provided him a copy of it, which means the Michigan Escanaba courts have known about all of this for 2 years.
Well, you know what that constitutes under 18 U.S.C. Section 4 of misprision of felony. If anybody who is in a position of authority, like a judge or a government official, they are given information that proves felony corruption or anything like that, if they don't do anything about it to report it to their higher-ups, then they are guilty of misprision of felony. 18 U.S.C. Section 4.
Okay. Well, apparently don't mean much in the state of Michigan.
That's because our federal courts are just as corrupt.
So the position that I'm in now is I'm facing a repeat charge for a case that I've already been found not guilty in. And it is going to be up to the judge to decide, do I get sent back to Wisconsin? Do I get sent to a Michigan prison? Or what? Because he's going, well, Michigan state law says something has to be done. Well, yeah, geez, if you really want to uphold the law, get my name cleared. But Michigan has no authority in Wisconsin. So because of all the corruption in Wisconsin, because of all the crimes in Wisconsin, because of all the rights violations that occurred in Wisconsin, and because of the fact that Michigan collaborates with these criminals so readily, I, the American people, now sit here in a power struggle between Wisconsin and Michigan as to who's going to violate my rights next.
Unbelievable. So that's where you stand right now. I understand you've got some kind of a hearing coming up, and what is that hearing for? And what today's date, by the way?
It's a pretrial on the 13th, which is coming up in less than a week.
That's June 13th.
At 2 p.m., at which time the judge is going to make a decision whether or not I should be charged with multiple felonies for having been found not guilty in Wisconsin.
My heart goes out to you. And today's date, by the way, is the June 8th. So we're talking just next week, beginning of the week, it looks like. Yeah. What's your reflection on this whole thing? I mean, how do you feel as somebody who has done all the right things, including blowing the whistle on a Sheboygan mayor who ends up feeling so targeted himself that he abscams out of office and out of the state, leaving you holding the bag for having blown the whistle on the corruption that you uncovered against him and his family? You know,
Very disillusioned. Very disillusioned. And you know, I used to have, I mean, I was in law enforcement myself. I had this belief that I was doing something good. And yet now that I have seen this much of the system, and I have seen what happens when you report the system committing crimes, that, you know, I mean, the entire notion of democracy, the entire notion of the judicial system, of, you know, officers being the good guys, is a complete lie. I have no faith. And the problem is even if I meet a cop who is a good, decent cop, I can't trust him, because cops don't go around saying good cop, dirty cop. And until something is done about these dirty cops, about these corrupt officials who are above the laws that we are held to, you can't trust any of them.
And we can't trust that we've got checks and balances between the governments anymore. We've got legislation that's unconstitutional. We've got cherry picking by the executive branch and the judicial branch as to what they will prosecute, what they will enforce under the so-called law. It's a complete farce. We've lost our government completely. This is my belief, and I think it's shared by many, that we don't have a government anymore. What we've got in its place is our usurpers of government authority and power. They're acting under color of law. They're acting in the capacity of corporations, and they are for lack of a better word, domestic terrorists.
Agreed. Yes.
And I'm so sorry that to hear this story. You contacted me just a few days ago, and it was such a horrific bunch of information for me to hear this over the phone. And I'm privileged to have met you, and to have received this story and to help you get this out there, because that's what RICO Busters is all about, is that we're trying to bust the racketeering that's going on through these government agencies and doing these injustices against we the people. And I want to thank you for your courage that's been going on for so many years to come forth, show your face, and say here's what's going on. I mean, that takes a lot of courage, and I want to thank you so much for that.
Thank you, Dave.